Okay, well, throughout history, money's always had a very revered place in society. You just have to look at the Bible, which tells us that money is the root of all evil. Shakespeare called money, thou common whore of mankind. The idea that there's this kind of mystical force, basically, that's on the one hand ubiquitous, you know, we see it everywhere. But on the other hand, it seems to be omnipotent, because all of our needs in society are ultimately relegated to the need for money within capitalist society. And the thing is, like all these kind of revered idols in society, whether it's the gods or religion, or today the idea of the law and the state, what we can do as Marxists is apply a Marxist method, a materialist and a dialectical method, and actually understand the origins of these phenomena, understand their evolution, their development. And if we look at it from this kind of historical materialist perspective, we can also see the actual real root of the problem, which is not actually money itself. And in doing so, we can understand also how to get rid of these symptoms of evil that seem to come from money. Now, if we study history, we actually see that money didn't always exist. Actually, the idea of money is tied in with the idea of class society, and particularly with the idea of commodity production and exchange. In the early days of humanity, society wasn't actually split into classes at all. You didn't have exploiters and exploited, but rather you had tribes which were based around communal ownership of the wealth in society and of the tools and the means of production by which this wealth was created. And Marxists refer to this as primitive communism. And if you want to know more about this, I recommend tomorrow's session on the origins of class society. But just to briefly go over it, the idea of primitive communism was you didn't have exchange between individuals, but rather you had this common ownership, a kind of a communism, if you like, where production was for the common good and consumption was on the basis of need from the common pot. But we call it primitive because, unlike the communist society that Marxists fight for today, it was primitive in the sense of it was on a very low level of economic development. It was communal out of necessity, actually, because there was scarcity and it was necessary for people to group together. There wasn't the resources and the development of science and technology to be able to have this kind of private ownership and class society and the idea of a minority of people who could live off the wealth and the labour of others. But within these primitive societies, at the fringes, there was exchange with other tribes. And through that exchange, you began to get the development of commodity production, where now, instead, people were starting to trade, and rather than produce for their own needs or for the needs of their own tribe, they were producing in order to sell. And this would originally be the surplus in society that was sold to other tribes in exchange for the things that they needed. And so you get the development of trade, and with it, the development of commodity production and exchange. But once it's developed on the fringes, it starts to spread internally inside the community as well. You start to get division of labour. You start to get private ownership. And more within the community, you get people producing not for their own needs, but for a market, for the consumption of others, for exchange. And that's what we refer to as commodities, the idea of goods and services produced not for individual consumption or for society as a whole's needs, but for the market, for selling, to exchange with others. Now, originally this commodity production and exchange takes the form of barter, basically the idea that people would exchange their commodity with someone who had a commodity that they needed. Now, this kind of primitive form of commodity production exchange is very very restrictive, actually, on trade itself. Basically, you've got to go and find someone who not only wants what you are selling, but also is selling what you want. And obviously, the chance of this happening is very restrictive. It means also, as a producer, you're having to carry around your actual commodities with you. If you want to find people elsewhere, who are selling what you need. And so the market, if you like, the idea of people coming together to exchange is very restricted, and trade itself is restricted. So what happens is in history, not by design, but by the necessity, if you like, of expanding the market, of facilitating trade, is that one commodity, a single commodity, emerges as what we call a universal equivalent, something that all other commodities can be exchanged for, that all other commodities can be kind of held against and can be compared to. And basically this then separates the act of exchange into two poles, a purchase on the one hand, where commodity is exchanged for this universal equivalent, which is in effect the origin of money. And then that money can be exchanged in a sale. The sale occurs first with the commodity exchanged for money, and then you have a purchase money used to buy another commodity. And so this commodity-to-commodity transaction is transformed into what we call the CMC circuit, commodity, money, commodity. And this universal equivalent, as I say, is really the origin of money. It acts as a means of exchange, as a means of allowing this circulation to occur. But as I said, it doesn't occur in a... This whole process, we're talking about a very long, drawn-out, evolved process that doesn't occur due to any design or plan, but occurs due to the needs of society, the needs for trade to expand. And in that sense, the actual initial commodity that emerges as this universal equivalent is fairly arbitrary and accidental, although it obviously has some sort of material basis in tribes where cattle is very important, then cattle becomes the universal equivalent. Where in places where rice is grown in large quantities and is the main source of food, bags of rice become the universal equivalent. You see, in studying different societies, lots of different universal equivalents that have emerged in these early stages. But it's unconscious and it's unplanned. Now, obviously, you can imagine being a trader and probably finding it quite inconvenient to have to carry your cattle around with you in order to then exchange something else, or giant bags of rice. Obviously, it's not a particularly convenient state of affairs for people to go around trading, carrying such cumbersome commodities with them. And in that sense, this is why, really, historically, the idea of precious metals as the universal equivalent seems to take hold. It's not for any sort of aesthetic reasons. Today, obviously, we revere the idea of gold and silver as these very precious metals. We consider them precious because they've got this long history of being used as money. But the reason they're used as money was not because of their aesthetic qualities, but rather because of much more material qualities that they had. For example, very durable. It means they're not going to, unlike your cattle or your bags of rice, they're not going to deteriorate. In that sense, they're going to store value over time. They're not going to lose their value from one moment to the next. They're very homogeneous in the sense that gold is gold is gold. All gold tends to look pretty much exactly the same. But they're also easily divisible. You can divide metals up, and that in that sense, one metal, when divided up or recombined, can represent lots of different quantities of value. But most importantly, these metals are very valuable in and of themselves. They require a lot of effort in order to produce. And in that sense, within this tiny lump of metal is contained a large source of value. So as I say, gold is money, not because it's of its aesthetic qualities, but rather we deem it to have these aesthetic qualities because it is money. Shows that even in the early days of money, there is a materialist reason for why the precious metals emerge as that universal equivalent. But I've talked about the idea of value quite a lot, but not actually explained, well, what is value? How is it determined? When we talk about some commodity being valuable, what do we actually mean? And to understand this, we have to go back and look at the idea of a commodity again. As I said, a commodity is goods and services produced not for individual use, but for exchange. And in this sense, Marx says commodities have a dual nature to them. On the one hand, they have a use value. There's something useful about them. There's a utility. Generally in society, these things fulfill some sort of need. But on the other hand, they also have an exchange value, which is different from this. How much of one thing is going to be exchanged for another? What's the quantitative relationship between two different commodities? And actually, there's a divorce between these two dual properties within a commodity. Because the things that are useful in society, or which we might consider most useful, are not necessarily the things that are also most valuable in terms of their exchange value. A pen is very useful and a car is very useful. But nevertheless, a car is considerably more expensive than your average pen. Meanwhile, diamonds actually have very little use value in terms of day-to-day society, other than their aesthetic qualities. But they are nevertheless extremely valuable. And Marx, in Capital, in his other writings, explains the origin of value. He says it's ultimately the value of a commodity is related to the amount of human labour that has been embodied within it. In other words, the amount of human effort that goes into producing that commodity. In short, I guess you can kind of say that time is money in this respect, the old phrase that we often hear. But the idea of this labour being the source of value was not a new idea, but actually had come from previous classical economists before Marx, people like Adam Smith and David Ricardo, and in fact had even gone back all the way to the classical ages, where they had a very basic understanding of the idea of labour being the source of value, not just the living labour, i.e. the labour that you put into that commodity yourself, but also all the raw materials and the tools that have gone in producing that commodity. All of that is dead labour, if you like, crystallised labour from the past that is transferred through to the current commodity. But Marx drew a distinction from the previous economists, pointing out that it was not just the individual's labour time that was what was causing value, but it was socially necessary labour time. In other words, if I take twice as long as my neighbour to produce a chair, I can't go to the market and charge twice the amount for it. But at the end of the day, it's the latest level in society, the historical and cultural level of technology and science and technique that determines the socially necessary labour time. If you're less efficient, you can't sell your products for more amount. And because in other words, what you see really on the market is not people, as I say, exchanging one commodity for another and comparing the labour times with each other in order to determine the price. No, all you see on the market is an objective price that emerges from all the exchanges, from all the interactions in society. And through this kind of constant back and forth of exchange, the price is determined. You're confronted in a shop with an objective price. You can't go into most shops in Britain and haggle over the price. It confronts you as an objective fact, but nevertheless one that has emerged from all the exchanges in society. It's a dialectical property, if you like, emerging from all the interactions, all the back and forth, all the buying and selling. Over time, the flow of information through prices determines what you see on the market. So price really is the product of money. When we talk about value, we're talking about the socially necessary labour time in a commodity. But the price is what you see on the market. It's the monetary relation of value. It's the monetary relation between different commodities. And in that sense, it's really a social relation as well, because it's relating the different quantities of labour of different people. But price and value, as I say, are not the same. Price is something that fluctuates on the market. It fluctuates with market forces, with supply and demand. But it always fluctuates around some sort of equilibrium. Marx pointed out that actually the market doesn't determine everything, because at some point, supply and demand must be equal to each other. There must be an equilibrium. And what determines then the actual quantitative relationship of one commodity with another? All that prices really do is provide this information. They provide a signal to investment, fundamentally. If you've got supply far in excess of demand, then that's going to push prices down below their actual cost of production, below their real value, and it's going to mean that people are starting to make a loss producing, and a certain amount of supply will come off the market. Vice versa, if demand is in excess of supply, then you're going to see basically people being able to make super profits and capitalists pouring investment in to take advantage of this and trying to bring back this equilibrium. So the role of prices is to act as this signal. It's the invisible hand that Adam Smith talked about that determines the flow of investment and of capital through the market. Now, on a day-to-day basis, obviously, the vast majority of us don't use money for investment, but use it merely for our own consumption. We use it to purchase other commodities. We're involved in this CMC circuit they talked about, buying or selling one commodity in order to buy another. But with that circuit emerges also its inverse, the idea of starting with money, buying up commodities in order to then sell them for money. And in fact, not just for the same amount of money, no one ever buys in order to sell and reach back where they started, but rather with merchants, what you see is the idea of trying to buy cheap in order to sell dear and make some sort of profit in the process. And alongside that as well, you actually get people who try and skip out the whole middle stage altogether and just try and make money out of money. The idea of money lenders, usurers, all of this emerges at the same time or in the same process through the historical development of money. But the thing is with such people is they don't really play any socially necessary role in society. These people are, on the one hand, they play a necessary role in facilitating trade and banking and finance and so forth, which is necessary for industry and for commerce. But at the same time, they're parasitic. They're not actually generating any new value in society. They're just transferring and moving it around. And in fact, the profits of merchants and usurers and financiers is not a real profit, if you like. It's not a profit that's increasing wealth as on a societal level. But merely it's cheating, really. It's transferring the wealth that's been produced somewhere else in real production. And this is what the classical economists before Marx couldn't really get their head around, is where did actual profits in society come from? Because if you just cheat your next door neighbour, that doesn't generate any new value in society. If everyone just cheats everyone else in the process of buying and selling, then the result is just inflating prices overall. If everyone charges the person before them 10% more, then eventually it's going to come back round to bite you in the behind. And you'll end up seeing your costs increase by 10% as well. It just leads to a general inflation in society. The idea is really that value isn't produced through the act of exchange and circulation, but rather exchange and circulation only distribute the value and redistribute the value that's been created in production. And so Marx understood, and Marx made the qualitative leap forward by explaining that new value had to come about from labour time, from the application of labour, and that profits had to be found somewhere in this process, in production, not in exchange and circulation. And he discovered that there was really one commodity that was very unique in that it could actually produce more value than it itself costs. And this commodity he called labour power, the ability of a worker to work. And it's this commodity that workers, in fact, sell. This is the only thing, in fact, the only real commodity that the working class has, is its ability to work for someone else, its ability to provide labour. And this is what is obviously sold to the capitalist. The ability to work is what is sold by the worker to the capitalist in exchange for wages. And wages are the money form, or the money equivalent, if you like, of labour power. And such wages are determined in the same way, Marx said, as any other commodity, in terms of the amount of socially necessary labour time needed to produce and reproduce the working class. In that sense, it's the food, the shelter, the clothing, the education, the training, the healthcare, all of these things that go into basically keeping the working class alive and going from one generation to the next. This is what are wages. And the capitalist pays wages in exchange for the worker's labour power, the ability to work for a certain period of time, whether it's a day, a week, or a year. And it's then up to the capitalist to basically extract as much actual labour from the worker within that time. For example, if the working day is 8 hours, then it might take, for example, only 4 hours for a worker to reproduce the value of their wages. In the space of half of that day, they're producing the equivalent of whatever it is they're making that would go into their wages in terms of the food and shelter and clothing and so forth. The rest of that day, the other half of the day, the other 4 hours then, from the point of view of the capitalist, is unpaid labour. They are not having to pay for it. And whatever they get from that worker in that time is effectively free as far as they're concerned. And Marx points out that's the real source of what he called surplus value. It's this extra free labor, if you like, the unpaid labor of the working class, ultimately, that is where surplus value comes from. And that surplus value is, in turn, where profits derive from. Now, this is different from other forms of class society. In slavery, for example, it's the actual slave themselves who is the commodity. Slave basically derives from the idea of a tool with a voice, is what it fundamentally comes back down to. In feudalism, where you had serfs and lords, then basically the serf's labour was directly appropriated by the kings and queens and the feudal lords. And in fact, in both of these earlier forms of class society, the vast majority of actual labour is being done not for the market at all, not for commodity production and exchange. But capitalism is that first form of society where the vast majority of the economy is now commodity production exchange, where the vast majority of production is being done for a market, for sale. And it's the pursuit of profit within capitalist society that actually drives society forwards. It's the needs of the capitalists to constantly try and reduce their own costs by investing that surplus back into new technology, into new science, into new technique, into new means of production. They're constantly trying to compete with each other to reduce their costs, and in doing so, capture more of the market, make bigger profits, sell cheaper than their neighbours. And this is what drives capitalism forward. This is what Marx referred to in the Communist Manifesto as creating wonders far surpassing Egyptian pyramids and Roman aqueducts. Ultimately, it's this production for profit that really defines capitalism, along with the idea of the wage labour and capital relation. In previous forms of society, you didn't have a class of people who had nothing to sell but their labour. In feudal society, people could work on the land. They had the land. They owned the land. Now, with capitalism, you have people ripped from the land and forced into the cities to have to sell themselves to the capitalists in exchange for wages. And it's that relationship, that capital-wage-labour relationship, that really defines capitalism. And capital is, Marx said, value that seeks to create more value. It's capital that goes out to try and make profit. And in that sense, not all money is capital. Just because we have money doesn't mean we have capital. It's a question of quantity and quality. Most of us don't have enough money to be able to invest at all. In fact, most of us will probably be in debt for large amounts of our lives. And obviously, it's only a certain group class of people who have enough wealth that they can live purely off the income stream that the investment of that money creates. Now, the surplus value created in this process is then divided up into profits on the one hand, but also into rent and interest. This surplus value. A certain proportion goes off to the bankers and the financiers. That's where the usurers and so forth get their money from. It's a slice of the surplus value created in the productive process. And as I said, at a certain point within the history of the development of money and trade, there comes the development of banking and finance itself, the usurers and the moneylenders, who basically deal with money as a commodity, which it is. It is a commodity with a supply and a demand, just like any other commodity. And actually, banking goes all the way back to about the 3rd millennia BC, where in Mesopotamia, for example, people would entrust the temples with their money. Basically, rather than wandering around with all their gold on them, which was liable to be stolen, they would deposit it at the temples, and in exchange get notes that basically were the equivalent of money, basically saying you could exchange these notes with other people, and it would guarantee that they could then exchange those notes at a temple somewhere else or a bank somewhere else and get the gold that instead of transferring all of this precious metal around. And in that sense, as I say, the banks are tied into the idea of money as a store of value. The fact that it's able to be hoarded and actually removed from the circulation process. In the Middle Ages, you start having the development of basically monasteries that start giving out loans and actually lending this money back out again. In fact, that's where the term mortgage comes from. Amorgage is basically a death pledge, a pledge that would only die upon redemption. Now, it's with international trade, however, that there's a qualitative change in this whole process, and you start to get professional bankers separate from these temples and monasteries and so forth, where basically there's a need for all these different coins that are coming from different parts of the world to be able to be exchanged and to be lent back out in the form of credit. And in that sense, the development of capitalism and international trade in particular is linked to the development of credit as well. The two are completely intertwined. The development of banks that actually loan back out money. The idea of banking notes and checks that can be accepted in place of hard currency, but are in fact backed up by the precious metals in the banks. And this is what money also takes on the role of, a means of payment, in other words. It's a way of paying off your debts, a promise to basically pay someone in the future, to pay the bearer of the money in the future. And that's why, in fact, if you take out a £10 or £20 note today, you should see somewhere on it written, "I promise to pay the bearer of this," whatever it is, the equivalent of £10 in gold. It's a historical anachronism relating back to these times. Now, what is the role of credit under capitalism? Well, Marx explores this as well, and points out that credit under capitalism has a dual role. On the one hand, it's basically expanding the economy through allowing increased investment. On the other hand, it's also helping motion within the economy, helping circulation itself. It overcomes blockages in the economy and allows for a kind of fluidity and an increased velocity. Basically, capital is dynamic. It has to be in motion. As soon as capital stops being in motion, as soon as there's a blockage somewhere in circulation, then you see commodities starting to stockpile up and can't be sold. And if commodities can't be sold, then people stop producing. And if people stop producing, then people become unemployed, and you get these slumps emerging. So capital needs to keep going, and credit allows that process to happen, because basically, rather than this stop-start of motion, where a capitalist would have to sell all their goods in order to buy the raw materials in to make the next round of goods, rather it allows them to borrow money and keep production going, keep them selling at the same time that they're buying. And at the same time, it allows capitalists to invest and accumulate, and rather than have to accumulate vast quantities of money in order to then put an outlay of investment in to expand their productive forces, it allows them to basically borrow from the banks and with the promise that they're going to expand their production and pay that loan back. So it's at the same time as allowing this motion, it's allowing this expansion of capital itself. It's allowing the expansion of the productive forces themselves. Now, alongside this role of credit, we also see it basically being used to artificially expand the market itself. The savings of some, particularly the rich and the big capitalists, are lent out to ordinary people, to households, to the working class, so that they can smooth over their consumption. For example, the idea of a mortgage, which is obviously a very large purchase that most people couldn't make in one go, but through credit is something that is accessible, although increasingly less accessible, to normal households. Now, in this sense, as I say, it's used to temporarily increase the demand in the short term, and in fact artificially expanding the market for commodities. That's what loans and credit cards ultimately do, allow us to buy today the things that we cannot afford. And really, in this sense, we see credit's role as basically trying to overcome the key contradiction within capitalism itself, the contradiction of overproduction, the fact that there's this constant tendency within capitalism for the productive forces to come into conflict with the limits of the market. Capitalism wants to expand the productive forces, constantly to try and, you know, make bigger profits, to accumulate greater wealth. That's the role of capital, as I said, to generate new value. But on the other hand, you've got this limited market. Why? Because at the end of the day, capitalism is this system of profit where the workers are only paid back a fraction of the wealth that they're actually producing. And that very fact means that the wages, which are the market for capitalism's goods, are always less than the value of the commodities that capitalism is producing. This is what we call the crisis of overproduction. And in fact, it's an inevitable product of capitalism because of the fact that profit is the unpaid labour of the working class. And credit is really a temporary way of, and I should emphasise, really only ever a temporary way of overcoming this contradiction by basically, on the one hand, allowing the capitalists to drive down wages and increase their profits, but on the other hand, lending back to the ordinary people the ability to buy, lending them money so they can actually carry on buying the commodities that capitalism produces. Because if they didn't, then, as I said, capital would stop. It would stop being in circulation. It would stop being in motion. And that's where you get slumps in the economy. But, as I said, it's only a temporary thing. And in the long run, all this does is really expand the productive forces and pave the way for these credit bubbles to burst and for even bigger crises to come about, which is precisely, obviously, what we're seeing today in the current crisis, which is a product of decades of a massive expansion, unprecedented expansion of credit, ever since the 1980s with the big bang of deregulation in Britain and elsewhere, where basically credit was used, loans, mortgages, credit cards, to basically overcome this contradiction of overproduction. It meant on the one hand, governments could attack wages and increase profits for the capitalists. But on the other hand, they could keep production going, keep the market expanding. And obviously all of this came to a halt in 2008 with the so-called credit crunch. But Marx actually pointed out that it's not the lack of credit that causes the crisis, but rather the crisis that causes the lack of credit. It wasn't the 2008 crisis was not simply a credit crunch in that the lack of credit caused the crisis. Rather, what you had is a system whereby suddenly people stopped lending to each other, the credit stopped flowing because people could see that that there was too many bad debts on the books. And it's worth exploring exactly how this process arises. And to understand it, we have to see how banking even works in its first place. The fact is, actually, the vast majority of money in circulation, which isn't even in notes these days, but obviously just numbers on a screen, but the vast majority of money in circulation is actually created by the banks themselves. It's not the cash that we see or the money that's printed at the Royal Mint. But it's actually created by banks in response to demand for loans. So basically, a bank will keep a reserve of its deposits. Ordinary people deposit money at the bank, and it will then loan out a vast proportion of that, vastly more than the amounts it has in reserve. Actually, will loan these out to people, in both capitalists, obviously, who want to make new investments, but also households who want to have mortgages and increase consumption and so forth. And so only a fraction of deposits is kept. The rest is lent out. And basically, this is lent out backed up by this small percentage left back in the bank. And all that money lent out, all that debt, basically, is the creation of money by the banks themselves. Now, if people start demanding their money back, savers start demanding it back, then obviously the bank needs to be able to cover that. And so they borrow from each other. But when people start, when the various banks realise that there's many debts that aren't going to be repaid, then obviously they stop lending, and that brings about this whole scepticism in the financial industry, and causes the contraction of credit and the contraction of production as a result. And basically, that's one. Then it also causes runs on the bank. People worried that actually the bank doesn't have the money there in the vaults to be able to pay them, and in fact, basically, a bank run, once it starts, is a self-fulfilling prophecy, because obviously the bank doesn't have all the money in the vaults that is lent out, and that's what we saw as recently as 2007 with the run on Northern Rock. Banks make their profits, as I said, from this. They get a slice of the surplus value produced elsewhere in real production. But we see it in the form of interest. They obviously loan out money to people and charge them a certain interest rate, but then borrow from others and charge a less interest rate. And it's those difference It's that difference that causes the banks to make a profit. But in general, interest rates reflect the demand for money in society. If there's a high interest rate, then basically people are encouraged to save, they'll deposit money in the bank, and it becomes more profitable to invest rather than it becomes more profitable to deposit money in the bank than it does to invest it, and vice versa. Low interest rates are used to try and encourage people to invest rather than to save. Now, as capitalism develops, this whole banking system begins to actually merge with industry itself. We see a merger of industry and finance, and in fact, the biggest firms start to gain access to the very own kind of financial arms. They develop their own financial arms. We see today, basically, big business will loan out directly to their consumers in order for them to buy back. You know, the fact that you can buy televisions or cars, for example, on money lent by those very same firms. But we also see the development of joint stock companies. In other words, capitalists that rather than going to the banks to gain money for investment actually start to issue shares. And basically the idea of issuing a share is that you're entitling someone in the future, you're entitling other people to a share of future profits, and selling them this piece of paper basically that entitles them to that. In exchange they give you money, and that money is used for capitalists to invest and hopefully generate bigger profits in the future. And so with the development of capitalism is this enormous development of the financial industry, this enormous speculation actually, because ultimately these shares become more and more divorced from the actual value that they represent. Loans, all these loans and debts and these shares become financial commodities that are traded and exchanged in and of themselves in an attempt to make money out of money. But as I say, the prices become actually divorced from the real value that they represent. Whilst the company might have a certain value tied up with all the machinery and the capital that it has, ultimately the price of these shares becomes vastly inflated in comparison to that. And these pieces of paper become completely divorced from what they initially were supposed to represent. And the result is these enormous prices, price bubbles and stock market bubbles. And Marx called this fictitious capital, the idea that it was all these commodities being traded, all this capital being traded, that actually had no real equivalent of value in circulation. And alongside this same process is the divorce of the capitalists themselves from the productive process. Whereas, you know, we might perceive of a capitalist as being someone who wears, you know, a kind of Mr. Moneybag style tuxedo and has his big 8-gallon hat or whatever it's called, you know, owning of the mill or of the factory. Today, obviously, really capitalists aren't business owners at all. They don't own factories or offices or anything like this. Don't even necessarily own tangible real assets that you can point to and hold. Rather, capitalism more and more, and the capitalist class more and more, have become merely just holders of shares, holders of these kind of financial assets that basically entitle them to a share of the total surplus value that's being produced in society. That's what we've moved more and more to. It's basically a capitalist now basically sees a piece of paper that they care about is the rate of return on that investment that they've made, and the capitalists just go and buy up whatever financial shares or debts or assets they can that guarantee them the biggest, or the told will guarantee them the biggest rate of return. And so now the capitalism become more and more abstract, if you like, and the capitalist class is less and less these business owners and more people who just own wealth, basically. And it's been reduced to a very pure form, if you like, of capitalism, just literally the owning of money. But as I said earlier, it's not that obviously anyone who owns this owns money is a capitalist. Owning shares does not make you really even a capitalist. Because obviously only a small minority of people, as I said, actually have enough shares that they could live off the income stream of those. And really what shares represent is not a move to diversify the economy or to make everyone a capitalist. This is sometimes what you hear being put forward in magazines like The Economist, which are really the kind of the serious mouthpiece of the liberal bourgeoisie. They're always saying, oh, you know, the way to get rid of inequality is for everyone to become a shareholder, everyone to become a capitalist. But really, for the vast majority of us, if we have pensions or savings that are invested in these sort of financial assets, it doesn't make us a capitalist. What it actually does is, far from diversifying and fragmenting capitalism, it actually concentrates wealth even more. Because who has access to these shares? What do they really represent? It represents the ability for the capitalists to now gain access to all our savings, for all these small amounts of money that we've accumulated privately and personally, to now be conglomerated together in these pension funds, in these hedge funds, in through the banks and so on. And the capitalists, therefore, have managed to, through the financial industry, turn all money into capital. That's really what the role of credit and all these assets represents, the ability to turn all these individual fragmented quantities of money into something that's qualitatively different, into capital that can be used for them to gain access to and make a profit. What I'm really trying to emphasize with this whole process, actually, is that there is no fundamental separation between capitalism and finance. There's no responsible capitalism, if you like, that's never had this kind of tumor of finance attached to it. It's not like the financial industry we see today is some sort of parasite on the side of capitalism, this otherwise benevolent system that we can just kind of chop away at. You know, this is what you see being put forward by the reformists, the idea that we can have good capitalism without the bad, you know, financial speculating side of it. But the fact is, they've been completely intertwined ever since the early days of capitalism, and they will continue to do so. To get rid of the bad capitalism is really to try and get rid of capitalism as a whole. Now, what we see today is these financiers themselves have really taken control of the whole society. Obviously, the example of Greece is a stark expression of that. But this isn't new either, actually. In fact, in the 17th century, the end of the 17th century, 1694, I think it was, you had the creation of the Bank of England, which was actually a private bank at the time. Basically, the different capitalists came together, but the government was completely bankrupt in Britain, having waged war with the French. And it needed to borrow money off the lenders. But the problem was, the kings and queens of the past had always had a tendency to default on their debts to the owners of money. So the Bank of England basically was formed by the rich coming together and saying, we will lend you this money, but it is going to be lent. You're going to have to return it with interest to us. And that interest is going to be paid out of the future taxes you collect from other people. And in return, we also want privileges. We want to be able to print money. We want to have exclusive banking rights. And that's basically where the Bank of England came from the capitalist class asserting its power. So really, you see, actually, this process is a historical fact of how the capitalist class takes over the state itself, how the government becomes actually beholden to the capitalists as early as 1694. As I said, in feudal times, the kings and queens would default on their debts, and the lenders could do absolutely nothing about it, really. But alternatively, kings and queens then could, or the state could just go and obviously appropriate wealth. It could just say, we're going to take your wealth in the form of taxes. But now, here you have an extraordinary development, where rather than seeing their wealth merely taken away from them and never to be seen again, the capitalist class now turn the tables on the state and say, no longer are you taking our wealth, but now you've got to borrow it and pay it back with interest. And so suddenly you see this complete inversion of power, and actually shows you the farcical nature of national debt, which develops with the banking system. Money, clearly, the fact that there's someone lending the money shows the money exists. It shows that there is the wealth out there to pay for the things that are needed. But obviously it exists, and it's tightly controlled by the capitalist class. And this is most obvious in Greece, where there's an enormous amount of wealth, obviously. There's an enormous amount of wealth that could be used to take Greek society forwards. but rather they're completely beholden to the money lenders in form of the Troika. And in fact, there's this ridiculous situation now where the IMF and the Troika and so will demand austerity. Why? So that the Greeks will pay back the money, will be able to be lent, rather, more money from the IMF to pay back the IMF the money. So you've just got this circle where all the money the Greeks are being lent is just going back to the very people who are lending the money in the first place. Now, to understand the banking system further, we have to go back and look at the evolution of money further as well. As I said, the precious metals emerged as the universal equivalent, and you get the development of coins, specific quantities of the precious metals representing certain amounts of value. And these are backed up by the state, which guarantee their value and their legitimacy. So only the state had the power to create money. That's why you see the idea of sovereigns, coins with the head of state actually stamped onto it. And today, obviously, we have the Queen's head guaranteeing the legitimacy of our paper notes. Now, again, as I said before, the problem is that the ruling class of old, and in fact today as well, had a tendency to get into debts and would try and get out these debts by basically just creating money and by reducing the value of gold or silver that was in the coins. But the result of this was you actually just got inflation, basically increasing the money supply through this process of what we call debasement. Debasement just literally means reducing metallic content. That's where the term comes from in terms of inflation today. All it did was the more they printed money or created money, the more inflation it would create. We see that phenomena as well in places like Weimar Germany, where in the early 1920s, in order to try and basically pay off its war debts, its reparations, the German government just borrowed and printed more and more money. And the result was this hyperinflation that actually completely devalued the currency to the point where people were wallpapering their houses with money because the actual paper was worth less than the value that was written on it. Basically the money was worth less than the value of the paper itself, sorry. Now, what this kind of shows is that the quantity of money in circulation isn't some arbitrary thing that the state can decide. There has to be a material basis to the money supply and to the whole economy. And the money supply really has its own laws and logic, if you like, which assert themselves dialectically. If you try and play around with this, then it comes back and bites you somewhere else. If you try and get out of debts by printing money, you end up just getting inflation, which erodes away the living standards of others. And in that sense, the quantity of money has to be linked to something material. It has to be linked, ultimately, to the value of the commodities in circulation in society. If you double the money supply without doubling the value of the commodities in circulation, the result will just be a doubling in prices, all else being equal. Now, originally, money was this commodity money. It was the money itself was a commodity that had a value, and the gold and silver coins were valuable because they were gold and silver, and they contained precious metals that were hard to obtain and difficult to mine and so forth. And the money supply, in that sense, was kept and prices in turn were kept very regulated by the fact that gold and silver were generally in limited quantities. Although there were cases like in Spain, the Spanish Empire, when there was a conquest of Latin America or South America, there was such an influx of gold from this conquest that actually ruined the Spanish economy by basically creating enormous amounts of inflation and uncertainty. Now, at a certain point, coins ceased to basically have the actual metallic content that they claimed to represent, and money became more of a symbol. Symbolic money, a token of entitlement to gold somewhere that was somewhere else in the banks, and eventually, as production expanded, the money supply expanded. There was a move away from the metals towards paper money, which basically played the same sort of role. And today, obviously, we've gotten rid of paper money, even in many cases, and we just have digital currencies, money that is just on a screen. It's a money of accounting to be able to tell you how much various people owe to each other. Nevertheless, the money supply, even when it moved to being representative, kind of symbols, it was always backed up by gold. It was backed up, the money that was issued, the notes that were issued by the Bank of England were backed up by gold in the bank itself. And this prevented money supply from being rapidly expanded because it had to be tied to the amount of gold that the country owned. And with this system, as you get more and more international trade, in the 19th century, you get the emergence of the gold standard, basically where different countries all tie their currencies to gold. And in doing so, you could obviously go from one country to the other and be able to directly compare prices. So, and this was particularly facilitated by the dominance of imperialism, and British imperialism in particular, which obviously required this international trade and comparison of prices and so forth. But the gold standard, whilst giving a certain stability to the economy throughout the 19th century, backed up by the stability, really, of British capitalism, British imperialism, nevertheless, it became unstuck precisely when the whole economy became unstuck at the time of World War I, when different countries, basically in order to try and fund the war, would start borrowing and printing enormous amounts of money, leading to large inflation. And the gold standard couldn't any longer handle all these kind of international imbalances in the situation. You had different countries, different imperialist powers, different advanced capitalist countries with different levels of productivity, different levels of trade and competitiveness. And basically the money supplies were being pulled in different directions. All the different countries basically, and this was exacerbated more and more with the Great Depression, which ultimately led to the end of the gold standard. All these different currencies couldn't be pegged to gold anymore because people were trying to, the different states were trying to print money in order to get out of the crisis. They're trying to stimulate the economy by printing more money, by you know, increasing liquidity, giving the banks more money to lend. But the only way they could do that was to come off the gold standard in order to be able to expand their money supply. And really what this was an attempt to export the crises that different countries were going through at the same time. You had a global crisis of capitalism, both after the First World War and then with really, you know, hitting its peak with the Great Depression. All these different countries trying to get out of these limits, or these national limits, this straitjacket, by exporting the crisis elsewhere, fundamentally devaluing their currencies so they could increase competitiveness, export more, trade more, and in doing so, basically grow their economies at the expense of others. It was what we call beggar thy neighbour policies. And eventually this led to the complete collapse of the gold standard in the Great Depression. By the end of the Second World War, what emerged was as a new international system called the Bretton Woods, which was basically a system came up with largely by John Maynard Keynes, the British economist. There's an international treaty that said basically the dollar would now be the new world currency and all the other currencies would be pegged to the dollar. But the only reason they could really do this was because the dollar itself was as good as gold. Two-thirds of the world's gold was in Fort Knox. And America was the dominant world capitalist superpower, emerged really unrivaled in the capitalist world. And it was able to use this kind of hegemonic position to break open trade barriers, to expand trade. And with the strength of the dollar, basically it allowed American capitalism to massively expand. And in turn, world trade expanded. You had the post-war boom. And there was, a certain stability to the whole system, the whole economic system brought about as a result of this. But that stability, again, turned into its opposite at a later stage, where American imperialism started to go into decline, started to have to spend more and more to keep its role in the world. In particular, in the late 60s, you had the Vietnam War with massive levels of military spending, Keynesian spending, really, inflationary policies on behalf of the American government. And all of this huge amount of money being poured into weapons and military created huge inflation in the American economy. And because all the other countries were tied to the dollar, it created inflation throughout the world. Not to mention the fact that many other countries, including Britain, were also enacting these Keynesian policies of government spend, of demand management, inflationary policies, basically. They were pumping money into the economy but without the commodity production actually increasing at the same pace. And eventually this led to the Bretton Woods collapsing as well in the 70s, pushed over the edge ultimately by the world crisis that came about in 73, 74, and the enormous oil shocks from the Middle East. And there was a move then to floating currencies, automatically adjusting currencies and exchange rates on the basis of supply and demand for these different currencies. And that reflected the competitiveness of different countries. If a country was devalued its currency, it meant it became more competitive on the world market. But whilst devaluation was able to improve competitiveness of a country in the short term, all it did was to basically help economies grow through exports. But it led to two different things. One, it meant internal inflation. Now, not only were your exports cheaper and allowed you to export more, but rather you also now had more expensive imports, which would obviously hit the real value of wages in a country. But more importantly, as importantly, was the fact that really all this did was, as I said earlier, it exports the crisis elsewhere. It wasn't really resolving the crisis on a world scale, but rather just basically one country trying to trade its way out of crisis, export its way out at the cost of another. And the point in here, and this is what's very relevant when you see the debates around the euro crisis today, is they constantly call for countries to basically increase their competitiveness. And by that they mean drive down wages so that they can produce less than capitalists in other countries. But the point is, competitiveness is a relative term. You know, you can't all be the most competitive. You can only be more competitive than someone else. And there's always, under an international capitalist system, going to be, with international trade, you're always going to be have some people who are net exporters, some people who are net importers. You know, there's always going to be basically winners and losers. The fact is that these imbalances, this instability you see, can only ever be transferred around within the capitalist system. All capitalist nations can do through their competition with one another is basically, as I say, beggar thy neighbour, get out of a crisis at the expense of others. And it really demonstrates what an enormous barrier the nation state has become in this current day and age, where you see these global crises emerging, and all these different nations, just like the different capitalists, are just competing against each other at the expense of one another. Now, the collapse of Keynesian policies, the collapse of Bretton Woods, led to the monetarist revolution in the 70s and 80s, embodied theoretically in people like Milton Friedman, and obviously politically in people like Thatcher and Reagan, who basically said that inflation was a scourge that had to be combated by supply-side policies. In other words, keep the supply of money low and fixed, and basically... tackle the rising the sources of rising costs, in what they saw as being fundamentally the problem of rising wages. They blamed the trade unions for causing inflation by demanding wages that were higher and higher. In fact, it was the other way around. You had inflation because of costs of production elsewhere, with oil production and oil prices going up, and all workers were trying to do was really keep up with that by going on strike and demanding better wages. But this monetarist revolution was used as an excuse to attack the working class, and basically keep wages down in order to keep profits high. Now, at the same time as this, obviously you then had this problem of overproduction again that the capitalists had to resolve, and the way around it was this expansion of credit that I talked about earlier. And 2008 really marked the end of monetarism as a kind of hegemonic theory. And all these accumulated contradictions have come to the fore. We see now all the same limits and contradictions of the gold standard re-emerging in the Eurozone, where all these different countries are pegged to each other in this one currency, and there's no way of them getting out. There's no way of them improving their competitiveness other than to basically have what we call internal devaluation, which is attack the wages in your country rather than devalue the currency and so forth. And actually, the Marxists predicted the euro crisis much earlier on, back in the 90s. You can read articles on In Defense of Marxism written by Alan Woods and Ted Grant, where they pointed out that the Eurozone would work as long as everyone was benefiting, if you like, as long as the general economy was moving forwards and all these countries were moving in the same general direction, the Eurozone would work. But as soon as the crisis hit, you'd have different countries moving at different paces in different directions, and all these contradictions would come to the fore. And as I say, the result would be that the less competitive countries would have to actually internally devalue by attacking wages and driving down the conditions of workers. And really it's that, this internal devaluation, that's the real meaning behind the austerity we see in Greece and Spain today. Now, elsewhere, and in fact across all the globe right now, the ruling class doesn't really have any solution to the crisis they found themselves in, particularly in the question of money. You know, all the traditional monetary policies in the past have failed now. There's no way out with these tools anymore. You know, interest rates would used to be used to stimulate investment, but now they're already at zero and there's still no investment. This is why you see this kind of desperate and empirical attempt to overcome the crisis through increasingly desperate measures, with the latest one obviously being quantitative easing, where the central banks, basically under instructions from governments, buy up government debt and buy this from other banks, and basically by taking these assets, by printing money and taking these assets off the banks then should have extra money that they can use to lend out for investment and for household consumption and so forth. And the idea is this should stimulate growth. But at the same time, obviously Keynesian policies have failed to work because of the existing massive public debts that are existing, that are there already. But the problem is businesses aren't investing. In fact, investment's at an all-time low, because it's not a lack of money that's the problem. There's huge amounts of money actually sitting in bank accounts. The biggest businesses in Britain sit on something like £750 billion. In the US, there's $2 trillion sitting in the bank accounts of the biggest businesses in America. 2 trillion euros in European big businesses' bank accounts. In fact, Apple alone in the US has something like $200 billion of cash reserves that it doesn't invest. It just sits there, this idle money. So the problem isn't the lack of money. The problem is the enormous excess capacity in the system, this enormous contradiction of overproduction, where basically no one will invest because there's already too much being produced. And so instead, all this money sloshing around, rather than going to invest and grow the real economy, all this quantitative easing and so forth, all this extra money being pumped into the system, all it's doing is causing massive amounts of speculation in art, in wine, in whiskey, in gold, in whatever commodities they can find. In onions, you had speculation onions in a few years back. And this is a constant attempt for the capitalists to find some sort of store of value, some sort of safe haven for their money. And quantitative easing is just leaking money into the global economy and blowing up asset prices, speculative bubbles, particularly in Asia and so forth. And in fact, therefore, rather than overcoming the crisis, what this does is actually just generally create more and more instability in the world economy. So what we see from the last 100 years of monetary systems and monetary policies is at a certain point they always reach their limits. Initially, they're a source of stability and allow for an expansion and growth of the productive forces and of trade and the market. But eventually, these strengths always turn into their opposites, and the money system becomes a source of global economic instability. And at these kind of crisis points, you get a paradigm shift, if you like, in monetary policy, where suddenly some new theory comes in to replace the old one. That's what you see with the move from the gold standard to Bretton Woods, to floating exchanges, to the Eurozone and quantitative easing. All of these occur in response to a crisis and a failure of the previous system, contradictions building up. But really, the real crisis is not in the monetary system itself or the money policy. The real crisis is the crisis of capitalism, which reflects itself in a crisis of the monetary system. It's the general crisis of capitalism, with all these contradictions building up, that exposes the flaws and the weaknesses of this or that system. And in fact, in that sense, it's the underlying crisis of capitalism that's the root problem. And today you get all these people talking about different theories of money and different proposals for how to get out of this crisis relating to it. But they're always attacking the symptoms of the problem and never really the root cause itself, because it's not money that is the root of all evil, as the Bible says. It's capitalism that's the problem. You've seen people proposing a return to the gold standard because they can see the effects of just printing money and the impacts that has. But the point is that inflationary policies by governments today are an attempt to overcome the overproduction and the economic crisis within the confines of capitalism itself. You see campaigns like Positive Money. Some people might have seen this campaign, Positive Money, which campaigns for the banking system to be brought back under democratic control and for banks to lend money only for real production, for real consumption, rather than for speculation and to making profits. But again, the point is that the vast expansion of bank lending is not just because there's greedy bankers in charge, but rather it's a response to the demands of capital itself to constantly expand and to grow. And the lack of lending for real investment actually just reflects the lack of profitable opportunities because of the global overproduction that exists. That's why, as I said, you've got this orgy of speculation and a situation where the stock market is completely divorced in terms of the value of the stock market to the real value that's there in the real economy. Elsewhere, we see these kind of anarcho-libertarians, kind of utopian types, who look for a solution in things like Bitcoin, digital currencies, which they think by taking the power of banking out of the hands of the state, the malevolent state, they can this will resolve the problems. But again, things like Bitcoin have not proved any solution either. They've actually just become vehicles for speculation. Because it's not the problem of meddling central banks that's the problem here, but the anarchy of the capitalist system itself. And these kind of utopian experiments can't really do anything about that. So really, to get rid of all of these symptoms of the evils of money means actually to get rid of money itself. But to go back to where I started, money is not something that was invented, if you like. It emerged from historical conditions, and it can't just be invented away either. Money can't simply be abolished, but we have to look at the historical roots of money to understand how it can actually be gotten rid of. And that means going back to the understanding that money arises out of the idea of commodity production and exchange itself. Money represents value, and value is a property of commodities emerging out of their exchange. It's a dialectical property emerging out of exchange between people in the market. To get rid of money means to get rid of commodity production and exchange itself. And that means returning to a communist society, to a society where there is again communal ownership over tools, over the wealth and technology in society. But again, like I say, this isn't going to be a primitive communism that we wish to return to, but a communism on a higher level based on a society of superabundance. So money will not be abolished overnight. Like the state or class society or human nature in general, it will wither away. There'll be a transitional period between socialism, a kind of lower stage of communism, if you like, and communism as a higher stage. Socialism begins with the taking of the main levers of the economy, the commanding heights, into the hands of the working class and putting them under a plan of production, a rational democratic plan in the control of the working class itself. And the more and more of the economy you bring into a socialist plan of production, the less and less there is in private hands. The small producers who are on the fringes of the economy, not big business, but who would take over by nationalisation and putting under workers' control, the small producers on the fringe, the petty bourgeoisie, if you like, will be incentivised to join the socialist plan because of its efficiency, its guarantee of a better standard of living. And the more and more that you bring the economy under this plan of production, the more and more you take it out of private ownership, the more and more you're abolishing commodity production exchange, and the less and less need there is, therefore, for money to act in these exchanges. The products of labour now become socially owned as well as socially produced, and we see the end of commodities themselves. Now, we can already see this process actually within capitalism itself, like all the kind of ideas of what a future socialist society will look like. We can see it today already. Today already, as well as the wage that you receive, the money you receive to be able to buy the commodities you need in exchange for the work that we do, we also have a social wage, if you like, a wage that we never really see, but in other words, goods and services that we receive for free because of things that have been brought into nationalisation. The health service is a perfect example. No, I mean, at the moment, fingers crossed, in Britain, people don't have to pay for their healthcare. You can walk into hospital and no money is ever exchanged between you and the hospital. Now, imagine that same sort of process, but now expanded to housing, to our heating and our transport, to our food and our clothing. In other words, bringing these main levers of the economy into a social plan of production, whereby we can walk into shops, we can walk into a house and know that the things we need are there for us and that they're there in exchange for us contributing to society with the work that we do. And that, in a sense, the social wage that you never see would gradually increase and increase, and the actual wage you need to buy things would be reduced to just luxury items and eventually be eliminated altogether, as luxury items also were brought into a plan of production and in fact ceased to be luxuries at all. So as commodity production withers away, so the need for money withers away also. And in its early stages, price signals would basically just be used to indicate where there's scarcity, where you'd still have banks that would accumulate the wealth in society that was being produced. But now, rather than prices being used to tell capitalists where they can make their profits, be used to show where there's a need for more investment by the socialist state, by the socialist banks. And the money, obviously, would still have to have some sort of material basis to it. In fact, Trotsky points out in The Revolution Betrayed how the Soviet economy under Stalinism, they thought they could just still print money at will. They thought they were masters of the universe. And actually, they ended up just causing massive inflation in the ruble that was the scourge of the socialist plan of production. So no, we'd still have money, but it would be anchored. It'd be anchored to real production. And it would be under the control and the genuine democratic control of the workers' state. And there'd be an enormous level of planning that we already see actually in society inside these giant multinationals. But now, rather than it being used to make profits, it'd be used to plan the economy on a global scale and get rid of the anarchy and the chaos of the market. And rather than representing exchange value, in other words, socially necessary labour time, money would more and more just become a token, basically, an entitlement to the share of the common pot. Kind of like what you see actually with rationing in World War II, where you obviously had a similar thing, but on a low level of economic development where there was scarcity of resources. But now we're talking about superabundance, where these tokens represent a share of the wealth produced in society. And eventually, as scarcity is eliminated, such tokens could be eliminated also. People become accustomed to a world of plenty where you walk into a shop, take what you need, and there's plenty there the next day for others to take as well. All our needs would be taken at free, all our needs would be free to take at will, because we know that scarcity is an aberration of the past, and we'd be able to live according to Marx's maxim that he put forward of each according to their ability, from each according to their ability, to each according to their need. Under capitalism, the ruling class peddles this myth, that basically justifies capitalism, that says it's the only way of doing things. It's the only system that ever has existed and ever can exist. And they try and legitimize and justify this exploitative and unjust system. They tell us capitalism is freedom and that, it's inevitable because of human nature. But as I said, if we apply a Marxist method, we can see that, different societies come and go, that in fact, far from being free, actually, we're in chains everywhere around us. There's the struggle, the daily struggle to make ends meet. We see Greece, which is far from being free, where people are being able to carry out the policies they voted for. They're being told what to do by the capitalists and their representatives in form of the Troika. So in other words, far from being free everywhere, we're in chains. We're in the chains of debt, in chains to the banks and the capitalists. And it's only under socialism, really, that you would gain real economic control, and with it, real freedom in a genuine sense. We'd be free, finally, from the power of capital and from the invisible hand. And just to sum up, in the words of Engels, we would ascend from the kingdom of necessity to the kingdom of freedom. I'll leave it there.